It's a 55-question episode with rounds on Trivial Pursuit, U.S. Geography, Oldies Name That Tune, Broadway musicals, and a confidence round about stuff that my new friends Sandy and Al like. This is Trivia with Buds. What? It be. And welcome to another episode of the Trivia with Buds podcast. I'm your host, Ryan Budds. I am a trivia host. I am a pop culture fanatic, and I am a dad for the second time in Southern California. That's right. My wife gave birth to our beautiful son, Tommy Dalton Budds, born November 19th, 2017. He was 8 pounds, 13 ounces, 22 inches long. Thank you so much for all the well wishes and tweets and messages and emails and texts and calls that listeners of this show specifically gave me. I really, really appreciate it. The boy's doing great. Mom's doing great. And it's so crazy. I called my wife earlier today and I said, how are the kids? And it was the first time I had said that. And I was like, oh man, we have kids now. So yeah, Tommy Dalton, Tommy named after my dad. His name was Thomas Budds. And everyone called him Tommy. I also have an older brother named Tommy who's been on the show a few times. Dalton is from the movie Roadhouse. So if you're wondering if that was because of Patrick Swayze's name in Roadhouse, it is correct. It's my one of my favorite movies of all time. One of my desert island movies, as I like to say. One of the three. Clue is also in there, and I'm not sure of the third one. But yeah, Tommy Dalton doing great. The second labor, man, so much easier than the first one. People always said that who had kids before, they're like, oh, the second one is so much easier. The second one just falls out. That's what people like to say. And it didn't fall out, but it was super, super less stressful than the first one. Just less pushing, less time in the hospital, all that stuff. And such an amazing thing. Super excited to be a dad again. So Tommy Dalton, welcome to the world. He had to get circumcised, which is something we didn't have to do with my daughter, obviously, because she doesn't have a penis. But this new one does, and that's what you have to do. So we had to, they're like, you have to go with him and console him while they do that. And I said, I hope he's never going to remember this. And I don't think he will, because it was his first day of life. And they put him on a little table and they strap him down, like kind of like a, you know, restraints, because they can't have him kicking around and messing it up. And my doctor is the best. Shout out to Dr. Aranez in Burbank, California. He delivered Annabelle and Tommy, and he was like, oh, I've done a million circumcisions. And he was like talking to me and really just did an awesome job. And he said, hey, I left a little extra on there for him. He'll thank me when he's 20. And I said, okay, that's a great doctor circumcision joke, Dr. Aranez. So yeah, it was quite the thing. It was kind of funny because he was like, okay, he's like, just send me a picture of it the next day and I'll tell you if it's healing up nice. And I'm like, that's kind of crazy that my baby is 2 days old and he's already sending dick pics to somebody. my wife and I, we've never sent like a dick pic or anything because we've been together since before you could easily send such a thing on your cell phone. We had flip phones when we first met where it was way harder to take that. There's such an angle on those flip phones. It was mostly a taint pic. That was like what you were if we were trying to do that, which we weren't, it would be like a, hey, check out this taint pic on MySpace, you know? So that's what's going on with me right now. Good transition into my mom visiting from the taint talk. My mom is in California for the first time in 50 years. She took the train out when she was like 18. I think I told this story on the show before in an intro a few weeks back, but she was like 18 or 19. She came out with a friend. She was going to start a life in California, and her friend got homesick after one day and they went home. And my mom never talked to that friend again. But she met my dad in a bowling league like a few months later. And I was the last of five kids from that meeting. So it worked out great for me. And now she's back out here. She's here for another 5 days or so with her sister, my Aunt Sherry. And we've had a bunch of fun stuff. Been doing a lot of old lady stuff. Mm-hmm. Shopping, watching Canadian shows on Netflix. They love the show Heartland. I don't know if anybody that listens to my show also watches Heartland, but it's about running a horse ranch in Canada. And boy, is it racy. Sometimes they almost kiss each other on the cheek on that show. So Heartland is what we've been watching a lot of, doing a lot of crossword puzzles, like no joke, like one of them will just start doing a crossword puzzle and we all chip in. Fun stuff and visiting and grandma, Thanksgiving we did. We had a bunch of Ashley's family over, about 25 people for Thanksgiving right after delivering the baby. And it was a really fun holiday. So looking forward to Christmas and all the days in between. I took them to see Murder on the Orient Express today. That's a perfect aunt/my mom movie to go see. They were familiar with the story. I was not. And if you're familiar with the story, there's no huge surprises from what I'm told. But if you've never seen it, I would say see it. It's not a great movie. It's kind of like a maybe like a 6 out of 10 type movie. I threw it in the pile of like Da Vinci Code, Angels and Demons, Dante's Inferno, which I never even saw Dante's Inferno. But it's like one of those kind of mystery thrillers where you're like, oh, this is cool, but I won't watch this over and over or anything like that. But we saw that today with MoviePass, which was great. Again, can't highly recommend MoviePass enough. If you don't have it, $9.95, as many movies as you want in a month. You can only go one a day, though. But who goes to more than one movie a day? Come on. I've also been watching a new TV show called Toast of London. Oh, my God. It's one of those shows where Netflix keeps going, you would like this. And I'm like, no, I wouldn't. It looks stupid. I don't know what this guy is. He's got a weird mustache. And it's the same thing with Peep Show, another British show that is my all-time favorite show. And I was like, this just looks like a dumb show with dumb people. And then I watch it and I'm like, this is hysterical. So it's very different. It's very slapsticky. If you're looking for a good new comedy, Toast of London, 3 seasons on Netflix. I'm right in the middle. I think I'm in the middle of season 2, but highly, highly recommend it. This week is kind of a crazy episode. It's kind of a thrown together episode just with all the stuff I've had going on with the holidays and the new sun. So bear with me. Next week, we'll be back with a regular one-on-one, which we haven't done in a while now, episode of the show where I have two friends of mine battling in topics that they're good at. My friend Randy Washington will be a guest with his friend Nix, I think, N-I-X. I got to look that up. But some great topics that they gave me. So a really fun episode coming up next week and a bunch of new fun stuff. If you like this show, I've got a lot of like bonus content stuff coming up. As soon as my family goes back home and I kind of get back on a schedule of making stuff every day, I've got a ton of new content coming out for you in terms of trivia related and pop culture related videos and music and all kinds of just cool, daily content on all my different platforms. So if you like this show, follow me on triviawithbuds.com on Facebook under Trivia with Buds and Ryan Buds and Ryan Buds on pretty much everything else. A bunch of good stuff coming your way. So because it's been a crazy couple of weeks, this week's episode is questions from 5 rounds that I used for a special 60th anniversary party that I hosted this weekend in Beverly Hills, my new friends Sandy and Al out there on the West Side. And these are questions I crafted for their 60th anniversary bash. Their daughter Julie hired me to do this party. It was really, really fun at a nice restaurant in Beverly Hills. And the questions were a lot of fun and the scores were very close. So I thought they would be fun to ask you guys, the listeners on the show. So I got 55 questions coming towards you in the form of Trivial Pursuit, U.S. Geography, Oldies, Name That Tune, Broadway musicals, and a confidence round about stuff that Sandy and Al love. I hope you play along. I hope you quiz yourself. And then I want you to tell me how you did, which is really, really fun for me to find out. You know, people go, oh, out of the 55 questions, I got 35 or 38 or 45. I love to hear about that. Or if you're playing against somebody, tell me who won. I got a great email from somebody this weekend that said, I forget her name off the top of my head, but she's an attorney. So if she's listening, she's my new lawyer friend. And she's like, yeah, me and my husband battled in the Seinfeld trivia and I beat his ass. And we heard you talking about 90210 and we'd love for you to do an all 90210 trivia episode. So maybe sometime in the near future, we'll do the teen soap from Fox in the 90s, 90210, which I grew up on and I know other people did. So that might be coming very soon as a suggestion from my new lawyer friend. We're going to dive into these questions inspired by Sandy and Al and 60 years of their matrimony. Here we go. All right. This is round one of our big 55 question quiz from my friends Sandy and Alan, their 60th anniversary party in Beverly Hills this past weekend. I want to reiterate those questions to you now in five different rounds. The first round is all about Trivial Pursuit, which was one of Sandy and Al's favorite games to play as a family. And boy, did they know a lot of these questions. So I got 11 random questions for you from the game Trivial Pursuit. Now, these are from a 20th anniversary edition of Trivial Pursuit that I have at my house. And I kind of just picked and choosed a few different ones that I thought would be great. So we'll kick it off right now with question number one, round one, Trivial Pursuit. Here's question one. What Arnold Schwarzenegger sequel is subtitled Judgment Day? Question number one, what Arnold Schwarzenegger sequel is subtitled Judgment Day? Question number two, what storied venue closed in 2000 after serving as England's national stadium for 77 years? Question number two, what storied venue closed in 2000 after serving as England's national stadium for 77 years? Question number three, Rowan Atkinson is a British comedian known for what mostly silent character? Question number three, Rowan Atkinson is a British comedian known for what mostly silent character? Question number four, what pungent herb does California farmer Chester Aaron grow 87 varieties of, including Creole Red, Spanish Roja, and Asian Tempest? Question number four, what pungent herb does California farmer Chester Aaron grow 87 varieties of, including Creole Red, Spanish Roja, and Asian Tempest? Question number five, what best-selling 1985 novel centers on an epic cattle drive from Texas to Montana? Question number five, what best-selling 1985 novel centers on an epic cattle drive from Texas to Montana? Question number six, what is the capital of Maine? What is the capital of Maine? Question number seven, what magazine changed its image in 1988 by putting a large HG on its cover? Question number seven, what magazine changed its image in 1988 by putting a large HG on its cover? Question number eight, who interrupted his retirement to play in the 1992 NBA All-Star Game, then was named MVP? Question number eight, who interrupted his retirement to play in the 1992 NBA All-Star Game, then was named MVP? Question number nine, what part of Disneyland and a failed George Clooney film title got a complete makeover in 1998? What part of Disneyland and a failed George Clooney film title got a complete makeover in 1998? Question number 10, who directed the film Fargo? Who directed the film Fargo? And question 11, this is the bonus question worth 2 points if you're playing along at home. Who wrote the 1922 poem The Wasteland? Who wrote the 1922 poem The Wasteland? Those are all the questions for round one, the Trivial Pursuit round. 11 random questions from the 20th anniversary edition of Trivial Pursuit. We're going to take a little pause here for a sound effect, and then we will go into the answers to round one, Trivial Pursuit. All right, there we are. We got the answers here for you. This is round one. This is the Trivial Pursuit round. Let's see how you did on the first 11 questions of this very special episode. Here we go. This was number one. What Arnold Schwarzenegger sequel is subtitled Judgment Day? The answer, of course, is Terminator 2. There you go. That's a nice easy one to start this quiz off with. Arnold Schwarzenegger, Terminator 2. He'll be back for like two more of those movies and probably some more along the way. What storied venue? This was number two on Trivial Pursuit. What storied venue closed in 2000 after serving as England's national stadium for 77 years? The answer was Wembley Stadium. A lot of famous concerts there, I imagine. Wembley Stadium. I didn't even know it was closed. I thought that that was a thing that you could still go to. Question number three, Rowan Atkinson is a British comedian known for what mostly silent character? Oh, I put this on the other night for my mom and my aunt. We watched him go shopping. His name is Mr. Bean. This guy's very silly. He doesn't talk much, and he goes on all these adventures, and he has a very distinct suit and a teddy bear he carries around. He's a real sociopath. Here's number four. What pungent herb does California farmer Chester Aaron grow 87 varieties of, including Creole Red, Spanish Roja, and Asian Tempest? I know that sounds like weed, but I was looking for garlic. The answer is garlic. Question number five, what best-selling 1985 novel, The Year of My Birth, centers on an epic cattle drive from Texas to Montana? The answer is Lonesome Dove. If you have an uncle, I bet they have that movie, TV series, in like a 2 or 4 tape set on a shelf in a dusty basement. Lonesome Dove, number five. That was the 1985 novel about the epic cattle drive from Texas to Montana. Number six, the capital of Maine, is Augusta. Augusta, Maine, all the way in the top right of the country. And Stephen King, a lot of his books take place in Maine. I don't know if any take place in Augusta, but I'm sure there's one or two, right? Under the Dome, is that in Augusta? Could be. Number seven, what magazine changed its image in 1988 by putting a large HG on its cover? It wasn't Playboy, it was Home and Garden. That's the H and the G, Home and Garden. Question number eight, who interrupted his retirement to play in the 1992 NBA All-Star Game, then was named MVP? Now, a lot of people, when they don't know a basketball question, will guess Michael Jordan for the 90s, which is a great guess, but we're actually looking for another MJ, and that is Magic Johnson. Magic Johnson from California. He jumped back in on that 92 NBA All-Star Game, and then he was the best player. How about that? Number nine, what part of Disneyland in a failed George Clooney film title got a complete makeover in 98? The answer was Tomorrowland. Tomorrowland. I thought this trailer was great. The movie looked pretty good. And then it kind of bombed, got bad reviews, and I don't know anybody that saw it. But when I asked this at Sandy and Al's party, there was a girl who yelled at me and said, it's not a failed movie, it's great. And I said, well, it didn't do well at the box office, so it's failed. She goes, you got to take the word failed out. And I said, sure thing. And I didn't do it. Number 10, who directed the film Fargo? It was the Coen brothers. The Coen brothers, Sandy and Al love the Coen brothers, so that was kind of a gimme for them. And number 11, for 2 points, who was the author of the 1922 poem, The Wasteland? It was T.S. Eliot. T.S. Eliot. If you know that poem, you're probably very emo. The Wasteland by T.S. Eliot. All right. Let's dive into round number two. Usually I pause between each round, and we will do like a song thing. But we're going to dive into round number two after just a short sound effect. Let's see what fun sound effect I can find. All right, round number two, all about a familiar subject in most people's lives, U.S. geography. Sandy and Al had spent a lot of vacations in Hawaii, so there are a few, I think three different Hawaii-related geography questions. Otherwise, just a bunch of stuff about the U.S., and we're going to dive into those questions right now. This is round number two, U.S. geography. Question number one. More than one-third of the world's supply of what fruit comes from Hawaii? Question one. More than one-third of the world's supply of what fruit comes from Hawaii? Question number two. What state used the slogan, great faces, great places? What state used the slogan, great faces, great places? Question number three. How many states border the Gulf of Mexico? How many states border the Gulf of Mexico? Question number four. As of 2016, what was the estimated population of Los Angeles? Was it 3.9 million, 4.2 million, or 4.9 million? As of 2016, what was the estimated population of Los Angeles? Was it 3.9 million people, 4.2 million people, or 4.9 million people? Question number five. In what state would you find the Liberty Bell? Question number five. In what state would you find the Liberty Bell? Question number six. Alaska was the 49th state. Hawaii was the 50th state. But what was the 48th state in our union? Question number six. What was the 48th state in our union? Question number seven. What holiday was celebrated in a southern state on Tuesday, February 28th, 2017? Question seven. What holiday was celebrated in a southern state on Tuesday, February 28th, 2017? Question number eight. In what state would you find Cedar Point Theme Park? Question number eight. In what state would you find Cedar Point Theme Park? Question number nine. What color is associated with Elvis and Hawaii? Question nine. What color is associated with Elvis and Hawaii? Question number 10, what time zone includes states that do not observe daylight savings time? Question number 10, what time zone includes states that do not observe daylight savings time? And question 11, for 2 points, which one of these two are not state capitals? Tallahassee, Pierre, Albuquerque, Springfield, and Cincinnati. Here it is again. The bonus question for U.S. geography for 2 points. Which one of these two are not state capitals? Tallahassee, Pierre, Albuquerque, Springfield, and Cincinnati. All right, those are the questions for round two, U.S. geography, with a little Hawaii tossed in for good measure. Let's go on to the answers to that round. All right, here are the answers to round two. This was U.S. geography. Let's see how you did. Here's question number one. More than one-third of the world's supply of what fruit comes from Hawaii? The answer, of course, pineapple. Pineapple. I didn't enjoy pineapple until I was about 25. A lot of foods kind of kicked in around the mid-20s. And I'm like, ooh, onions. Ooh, pineapple. Ooh, green peppers. I didn't like that stuff as a kid or a teenager. Question number two, what state used the slogan, great faces, great places? That was a reference to Mount Rushmore, which is in South Dakota. South Dakota. Question number three, how many total states border the Gulf of Mexico? There are five Gulf states. Five states. I've been to a few of them, but not most of them. Question number four, as of 2016, what was the estimated population of LA? It was the first choice, 3.9 million people. In LA. I am one of them, kind of, on the outskirts. I don't know if they consider it LA. Maybe LA County. LA County is huge. So we're going to count it. Number five, in what state would you find the Liberty Bell? That was a nice history question for you. Pennsylvania, Philadelphia. Number six, Alaska was the 49th state. Hawaii was the 50th. And the 48th state, Arizona. Arizona, the 48th state in our union. Question number seven, what holiday was celebrated in a southern state on Tuesday, February 28th, 2017? I was looking for Mardi Gras or Fat Tuesday. Either one of those was good, Mardi Gras or Fat Tuesday. Number eight, in what state would you find Cedar Point Theme Park? It was Ohio. I think it's Sandusky, Ohio. I'm not sure, but I have never been there. I hear it's the best if you like roller coasters. Number nine, what color is associated with Elvis in Hawaii? Blue. There's a Elvis song and movie called Blue Hawaii. I think my mom has the vinyl of it. Number 10, what time zone includes states that do not observe daylight savings time? I was looking for Mountain, the Mountain time zone, which some people don't even know exists, but Mountain was the answer. And the bonus, which two of these are not state capitals from this list of five? We had Tallahassee, Pierre, Albuquerque, Springfield, and Cincinnati. The two fake ones are Albuquerque and Cincinnati. Albuquerque is the city in New Mexico, but the capital of New Mexico is Santa Fe, and Cincinnati is where the girls call me daddy. That's what Fred Durst taught me in a song called All Around the World or something like that. It's terrible. Cincinnati is in Ohio, but the capital is Columbus, Ohio. So enjoy those questions about U.S. geography, and we are going to dive into round number three. In just a second, it's a Name That Tune round. So get your ears ready for some Name That Tune oldies trivia in just a second. Here's a fun sound effect. All right, this is going to be a fun audio one for you to listen to wherever you're listening to this show. Maybe you're in your car, maybe you're walking the dog, maybe you're on the treadmill, maybe you're walking a dog on the treadmill. That'd be fun. I've seen that before on YouTube and things. Get ready. This round is a Name That Tune round. This is from 57 to 67. So popular songs from that decade. This was the first year my friends Sandy and Al were married. And we got one song for every year. So I am going to play those songs for you, starting with number one from 1957. Number two is from 1958, and so on and so forth. All you have to do, if you're playing along at home, name the name of the song or the artist. Since most of my listeners, I don't think, are from this era, just name either the song or the artist and tell me how you did at the end of the round. So this is round number three, Name That Tune, Oldies, 1957 to 1967. Here is song number one.
Find a wheel and it goes round, round, round as it skims along with a happy sound as it goes. along the ground, 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 till it leads you to the one you love. Then your love will hold you round, 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 and your heart's a song.
Song number two.
So lonely. Hurry back, hurry back.
Here comes song number three.
Every night I hope and pray a dream lover will come my way.
Girl. All right, here's song number four.
Out in the West Texas town of El Paso, I fell in love with a Mexican girl. Nighttime would find me in Rose's Cantina. Music would play and 39 would whirl.
Song number five on your list.
I'm a traveling man, made a lot of stops all over the world.
Here comes song number six. Song number seven, here it is. Song number eight.
There she was, just walking down the street singing. Do what did it, did it, dum, did it, do. Tapping her fingers and shuffling her feet singing. Do what did it, did it, dum, did it, do. She looked good, looked good. She looked fine. Looked fine. She looked good, she looked fine. And I nearly lost my mind. Before I knew it, she was walking next to me singing.
Here's song number nine.
Let me tell you about the birds and the bees and the flowers and the trees and the moon up above and a thing you call love. Let me tell you about the stars in the sky.
And song number 10. Here's your bonus question. On this last one, I want you to name the artist and the name of the song. So here is the bonus question, song number 11.
Just when you need.
All right, here's a fun sound effect in between the questions and the answers, and then we will dive into those answers. Okay, so here are the answers to round number three. This was the name that tune round. Here was song number one. And the answer was Round and Round by Perry Como. Round and Round by Perry Como. Here is the answer to song number two. Let's hear it first.
Return.
And here's the answer. It was Return to Me by Dean Martin. Return to Me by Dean Martin.
I'm so alone.
Here's number three. Let's listen again. And that was Dream Lover by Bobby Darin. Dream Lover, Bobby Darin, played by Kevin Spacey in a movie called Beyond the Sea, which I guess we'll have to edit the whole movie now. Just take all the Kevin Spacey parts out. It'll just be his managers and friends and family talking about him in a five-minute film called Beyond the Sea. Here's number four. This is the song. And the answer was El Paso by Marty Robbins, brother of Baskin, who runs an ice cream parlor you may have eaten at before. That's not true. El Paso by Marty Robbins. Here is number five. That's Ricky Nelson from the show Ozzie and Harriet, if you remember Ricky Nelson. And the show is song is Travelin' Man. Travelin' Man by Ricky Nelson. Here was number six. This was the song. And the answer was Hey Baby by Bruce Channel. Hey Baby by Bruce Channel. Question seven. Here's the song. That's a great song. Be My Baby by the Ronettes. That's from the opening scene in Adventures in Babysitting, which I've seen more times than a 32-year-old man probably should have, but I do love that movie. Adventures in Babysitting, the song Be My Baby by the Ronettes. Here was question eight. Here's the song.
Just walking down the streets.
And, of course, the answer was Doo-a Diddy Diddy. Diddy-dum-diddy-doo by Manfred Mann. Doo-a Diddy Diddy is the official title. And Manfred Mann was the group. I think they were a UK group. Here's question number nine. Here's the song. And the answer was The Birds and the Bees by Jewel Atkins. A key when identifying songs from the olden days are they always say the title sometimes to start the song, and then the song's only like a minute and 40 seconds long. That's how you know you found a good oldie. So that was The Birds and the Bees by Jewel Atkins. And number 10, here's the song. And that, of course, was Reach Out and I'll Be There by The Four Tops. Or as my Aunt Sherry called them the other day, the Four Box Tops, when she was trying to recall the name of the group. Reach Out and I'll Be There by the Four Tops. And your bonus question, here's that last song. And the answer was Everlasting Love by Robert Knight. That was not a super easy one to end with, so maybe you got it, maybe you didn't. Everlasting Love by Robert Knight. All right, that's the end of round number three, the Name That Tune Oldies round. Hope you did well. And here's a fun sound effect to break up the rounds. All right. Hope you're having fun with this episode playing along. Again, don't forget to email me or tweet me or reach out to me and let me know how you did out of the 55 questions. This is round number four. It's all about Broadway shows and musicals. Let's see what you know about Broadway. Here's question one. What musical from Andrew Lloyd Webber debuted in 1981? Question one for Broadway musicals. What musical from Andrew Lloyd Webber debuted in 1981? Question number two, Bring It On the Musical is based on a movie about what sport? Bring It On the Musical is based on a movie about what sport? Question number three, what modern musical starts with a summarization of the title character's early life in the Caribbean? Question three, what modern musical starts with a summarization of the title character's early life in the Caribbean? Question number four. What musical stars characters named Dr. Dillamond, Madame Morabil, and Glinda? Question four. What musical stars characters named Dr. Dillamond, Madame Morabil, and Glinda? Question number five. Who starred the 1996 film version of Evita? Question number five. Who starred in the 1996 film version of Evita? Question number six, what single word musical had a song called We'd Like to Thank You, Herbert Hoover? Question six, what single word musical had a song called We'd Like to Thank You, Herbert Hoover? Question number 7. What was the first musical written by the team of Rodgers and Hammerstein in 1943? Question 7. What was the first musical written by the team of Rodgers and Hammerstein in 1943? Question number 8. Mamma Mia is a musical about the music of what band? Question 8. Mamma Mia is a musical about the music of what band? Question number 9. In the 2001 musical, The Producers, who played Max Bialystock? Question number 9. In the 2001 musical, The Producers, who played Max Bialystock? Question 10. What word is stamped at the top of most Broadway programs with black font on a yellow background? Question 10. What word is stamped at the top of most Broadway programs with black font on a yellow background? And question 11. This is the bonus question for Broadway musicals. For 2 points in 2007 and 2011, what were the last two Disney Broadway musicals? For 2 points in 2007 and 2011, what were the last two Disney Broadway musicals? All right, we'll be back in just a second with the answers to round 4, the Broadway musical round. Okay, we're back with the answers to Broadway musicals. Let's see how you did on round number 4. We got one round to go, and here are the answers for round 4. Question 1, what musical from Andrew Lloyd Webber debuted in 1981? The answer was Cats. Cats was the answer. I asked somebody that the other day. I go, is this something I need to see before I die? And they said, no, you don't need to see it. So I probably will never watch Cats. Question number 2, Bring It On the Musical is based on a movie about what sport? The answer is cheerleading. Somebody at the party said, that's not a sport. And I was like, you're an old white guy. Number 3, what modern musical starts with a summarization of the title character's early life in the Caribbean? The answer is Hamilton. A lot of rap in that thing. Rapping all over the place. That always pops up on Amazon Prime. It's like, if you like listening to Weird Al, you'll probably like Hamilton. And I'm like, will I? Number 4, what musical stars characters named Dr. Dillamond and Madame Morrible and Glinda? Glinda is the key there. She's the witch in Wicked. Wicked. That is one of the few Broadway musicals I've seen. Took the wife to see it before we were married. And we were just some youngsters in our early 20s, and we saw it in Chicago. It was fun, from what I remember. I don't remember much of it. Number 5, who starred in the 1996 film version of Evita? The answer was Madge. Madonna. Her name is Madonna, and she used to be married to Guy Ritchie, and I don't think she is anymore. Number 6, what single-word musical had a song called We'd Like to Thank You, Herbert Hoover? The answer was Annie. I don't know anything about Annie, except that Cameron Diaz looked uncomfortable in the trailer for the new Annie with Jamie Foxx. And she was doing a weird accent. But that was the answer, Annie. Number 7, the first musical written by the team of Rodgers and Hammerstein in 1943 had an exclamation point in the title. It was Oklahoma. And I literally know nothing about Oklahoma, the musical, or the state. So take that, Midwest. Number 8, Mamma Mia is a musical about the music of what band? It was ABBA, which is a palindrome, because it's the same thing, forwards and backwards. ABBA, A-B-B-A, was the answer. My mom loves that movie. Number 9, in the 2001 musical, The Producers, who played Max Bialystock? He's a big player on Broadway and in the voice of Timon, I think, in The Lion King. Nathan Lane was the answer. Nathan Lane, he's all over Broadway. Number 10, what word is stamped at the top of most Broadway programs with black fonts and a yellow background? I was looking for playbill. Playbill, like when you get a program at a Broadway show. I think the only other Broadway show I've seen was Book of Mormon, which was good. Liked it a lot. Here's the bonus. For 2 points in 2007 and 11, what were the last two Disney Broadway musicals? The answers were The Little Mermaid and Aladdin. The Little Mermaid and Aladdin. They got 5 new ones on the horizon, from what I remember in the Wikipedia article. They're doing Pinocchio and Hercules and maybe Mulan. I think that was 3 of the 5, and some other ones. So those are the answers to round 4 Broadway shows, and we are going to dive into our last round, the confidence round, about stuff that Sandy and Al loved. Let's see how you do with that round right now. There's no 11th question, so there's no bonus. You can cross that out if you're playing along at home. And if you are playing along, take a picture of your little scorecard. Take a picture and send it to me. Tweet it to me. I'd love to see it. See how you construct your little scorecard. And if you want me to make one, I think I made one time and posted it on my website. I don't think that link is active anymore, but I might make a official play along at home version so you can print it off and really score yourself in style. Here is, you know what I wanted to do? I wanted to make a little whiteboards for people that play along at home, like if they're going to battle their spouse or their partner, and you have a little like Trivia with Buds whiteboard that you can put the score on. So if that's something you're interested in, send me an email and I'll send you one very, very cheaply, if not free. Okay, here is the last round, 10 questions. Now, if you're playing along at home, you're going to rank all your answers. So write down all your answers first, then rank them 10 to 1 based on how confident you are in the answers. And 10 is the most confident, 1 is the least confident. You have to use each number one time. You can't give everything 10s or 1s. If you got all those right and ranked, you'd have 55 points. So, be honest with yourself and give yourself a nice ranking of this quiz in these last 10 questions. Here is round number 5, the confidence round about stuff Sandy and Al love. Question number 1, what lake in Minneapolis, Minnesota is connected to Cedar Lake and Lake Calhoun? That's a tough question unless you live in Minnesota. Number 1, what lake in Minneapolis, Minnesota is connected to Cedar Lake and Lake Calhoun? Question number 2, who is the original host of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? This is the U.S. version. I'm looking for the original host of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire. Question number 3, what network does Blue Bloods air on? What network does the show Blue Bloods air on? Question number 4, how many points is a full house worth in the original Yahtzee? How many points is a full house worth when you're playing Yahtzee? Question number 5, what is the last name of the two brothers on Property Brothers? What is the last name of the two brothers on Property Brothers? Question number 6, what color represents history in the original Trivial Pursuit? What color represents history in the original Trivial Pursuit? Question number 7, what Coen Brothers movie is loosely based on the epic story The Odyssey? Question 7, what Coen Brothers movie is loosely based on the epic story The Odyssey? Question number 8, what film depicts the lives of 4 real estate salesmen over 2 days? Question 8, what film depicts the lives of 4 real estate salesmen over 2 days? Question number 9, what is the traditional wedding gift for a 60th anniversary? What is the traditional gift for a 60th wedding anniversary? And the last question of the show, who won the election in 1960 for U.S. president? Question 10, who won the 1960 election for U.S. president? All right, we'll be back in just a second. Hold your horses and get ready to score yourself on this very last round, the confidence round, based on stuff my friend Sandy and Al dig. Here are the answers. All right, here are the answers to that round, the last round, the confidence round. Let's see how you did. Hopefully you ranked them all the ones that you nailed, and you're going to get the highest score possible out of 55. Here we go. Number 1, what lake in Minneapolis, Minnesota is connected to Cedar Lake and Lake Calhoun? The answer was Lake of the Isles. Lake of the Isles, very specific Minneapolis-based lake question for you to kick off the round. Question 2, who was the original host of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? The answer, Regis Philbin. Regis Philbin, my mom and dad used to watch this show on separate floors of the house in separate rooms and scream the answers to each other before the other person could get it, and the other person would swear at the top of their lungs. And that's where I learned some of my best swearing. Question 3, what network does Blue Bloods air on? The answer is CBS. CBS. Blue Bloods, my mother-in-law Tanya tells my daughter when she watches this show, she goes, oh, there's your new grandpa. There's your new grandpa. And she points at Tom Selleck. So we were at a Mexican restaurant and my daughter saw our waiter who had a giant bushy mustache. And she said, oh, there's my new grandpa. And we all had a nice laugh. So that was pretty great. Question 4, how many points is a full house worth in the original Yahtzee? 25 points. 25 points if you know your Yahtzee scoring, which you should. Question number 5, what is the last name of the two brothers on Property Brothers? I've never seen this show. The answer is Scott. But when I looked up this answer, I searched Property Brothers, and then Google was like, gay? Are the Property Brothers gay? Which was interesting. So that was the first search result if you were searching for Property Brothers, but their last name is Scott. Question number 6, what color represents history in the original Trivial Pursuit? The answer is yellow. Yellow is all about the history. Question 7, what Coen Brothers movie is loosely based on the epic story The Odyssey, one of my favorites, Oh Brother, Where Art Thou? Oh Brother, Where Art Thou was the answer. Question number 8, what film depicts the lives of 4 real estate salesmen over 2 days? I haven't seen this movie, but it's Glengarry Glen Ross. A lot of big actors in this one. Coffee is for closers, I think is the big line from this movie, and probably some racist type stuff. Here's question number 9. What is the traditional wedding gift for a 60th anniversary? The answer, diamond. Diamond. That's the answer. Diamond for the 60th anniversary. And number 10, who won the election in 1960 for U.S. President? JFK, John F. Kennedy Jr. Check that out. No, Jr.? Was he Jr.? I don't know. JFK. That's all I know. It's not JFK JR. It's just JFK. So he was the answer to the last one. How did you do? That was the last 10 questions of this episode. Hope you enjoyed it. And here's a quick outro. While you're finishing up scoring yourself and you're circling your score and you're putting it on your fridge, we'll dive into some outgoing notes. So here we go. Boom, there they are, 55 questions on some fun topics. Thanks to Sandy and Al for being married for 60 years so I could write those questions and then reiterate them to my podcast listeners. How'd you do? How'd you do out of the 55? That's what I want to know. Send me an email, ryanbudds@gmail.com. Send me a tweet at ryanbudds. Say, hey, buds, I got 50 of them right. That would be cool. That'd be a good score. Do you like these all trivia-based episodes? That's what I want to know. Quick survey. Also, let me know about that on some kind of social media. Do you like when I'm just asking trivia questions in this format? Do you like the variety of me on location somewhere asking people questions? Do you like when I'm quizzing 2 friends like I teased for next week again? Or do you like when I'm interviewing someone like Craig Bartlett from Hey Arnold and I kind of mix some trivia into the conversation? Let me know. And thank you so much for leaving all the recent reviews on the iTunes page that got me up to 75. I was asking people to do that for a while, and we just hit 75, so thank you so much. Shout out to Tom AZZ _, who left one on November 16th. He said it was 5 stars, and he said, I recently found this podcast, and it quickly moved into my must-listen rotation. Thanks, Tom. Great question and funny banter. I'd highly recommend it. That was very nice of you, Tom. Thank you, sir. And Ashes in Pompeii left a review. They said, Ryan's a great host with questions from all over the pop culture map, from wrestling to Disney. It's a great listen on Tuesdays. Give it a listen. Thanks so much, guys. I really appreciate that. And email me, ryanbudds@gmail.com, if you are Ashes in Pompeii or Tom AZZ _, and let me know who you were, and I will send you like a swag bag, send you some stuff for leaving those reviews. Anytime anybody leaves me a review on this show, send me an email just so I can match it up with the name on iTunes, and I'll make sure to get you some good free stuff. Remember, you can still book me for a holiday party if you live in the Southern California area, or if you live far and you don't mind flying me out or paying a little extra for me to buy a flight. I'd love to do your party in December or January. I've been booking a bunch of holiday functions and Christmas parties and things like that, and I would love to fit yours in if I can. Again, email ryanbudds@gmail.com, and I'll send you all the details. Also, check out triviawithbuds.com. You can click the contact form. You could see past reviews on Yelp and all different kinds of party information on the website. And I always have a ton of ideas if you want me to supply like a certain type of round, or if you want me to kind of just, you know, suggestively go, oh, these would be 5 great rounds for your organization or your company. Things like that. I would love to work with you. Shoot me an email and we will talk about it. Thank you guys so much for listening, telling a friend about this show, and rate, reviewing, and subscribing on iTunes. It all means a whole bunch to me. And again, we're getting right back on track here at the end of 2017 with some great episodes around the corner. We'll see you next time for more Trivia with Buds. Bye-bye.